Learn how you can use GitHub Copilot to automate the testing of your data, but also learn how you can use GitHub Copilot and VS Code to do all sorts of other things data related you never thought you could do. You never imagined you could do. This week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Hamish Watson. Hamish, thanks so much for coming back on Data Exposed. It's been a really long time. I'd love if you could give us a little bit of a reminder about who you are and what you do.
Yeah, thanks, Anna, and g'day, everyone. It's absolutely brilliant to be back. It's been a couple of years, and the cool thing is technology has changed in those years, so here I am again. Hi, I'm Hamish Watson. I'm a data platform MVP, just got renewed, so very happy about that. And I am a DevOps and data consultant based in New Zealand. And my tagline basically in life is make stuff go. And today's session is sort of adheres to that premise because, you know, this whole artificial intelligence thing has definitely helped me make stuff go a little bit faster and better.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah. And today we're talking about GitHub Copilot for test data generation. This isn't something I really know anything about. So I'd love to understand, just kind of level set quickly before we get into the demo, like what does that mean? What's the scenario?
Yeah, sure. One of the... Because I run a consultancy company, and so I go out and I work with clients and we build some great data models and databases and all that. And one thing that sort of is hard for people is how to test their data, because testing data is hard. And one of the things that that came about from my use of Copilot was, hey, we can actually synthetically generate data using artificial intelligence, or let's be honest, machine learning, because what happens is all these, you know, cool algorithms and stuff go away and look at large language models and give us the content that allows us to generate synthetic data, simulate, you know, some tests and what have you, because writing unit tests for data is also hard. And so for me, GitHub Copilot has been a massive game changer in the way that we can test our data and start folding that into DevOps or CI/CD processes and pipelines.
Cool. Awesome. So should we take a look?
Yeah, absolutely. Alrighty, so I've got a bit of an agenda here to sort of keep me on track. And so as I mentioned, you know, GitHub Copilot allows us to do the automation of data generation scripts. And so GitHub Copilot, and I'll be showing this in the demo, all of today is demo-based. And so it will help us write scripts to generate synthetic data by providing both code suggestions and completions for, you know, functions and what have you that can create our data sets. You know, it can suggest code to create random data points for testing, say, machine learning models. And also another really good aspect of it, you know, we're going to write some code. Well, GitHub Copilot is going to help us write some code to generate realistic example data. And so we might give it name, address, date, street address, and it will generate, you know, that test data for us. Because often I find people will take a copy of production, bring it down into test, and try and anonymize the data in there. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that doesn't work too well. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this is really great because we also can then start simulating complex data structures, because that's probably a quite hard thing to do, you know, with got to deal with either JSON or XML or whatever. And, you know, we can actually start using it to suggest the layout of the data structures. Because I've got to be honest, when I start trying to write something in JSON for an API, I struggle a little bit. You know, I come from a SQL background, so T-SQL, yep. P-SQL even, I can write on all those. But yeah, JSON XML, yeah, not my jam. But the cool thing is, you know, GitHub Copilot can really help us do some of the stuff. And of course, privacy, right? So generating the synthetic data allows us to replace, you know, real data in a way that preserves, you know, what the properties that we want whilst ensuring privacy. So, you know, nicely randomizes the data and everything. And so, again, this is really, really important and useful for when we share that data and we're collaborating, you know, our project across various parts of the business or whatever without exposing sensitive information. Now, I won't go over it today, but, you know, you can use generative AI tools like GitHub Copilot to actually ingest the output of your database or your data store or what have you, and actually give it rule sets in terms of, hey, is there sensitive data in here that can identify individuals or whatever? Wow. Yeah.
Awesome. How does it work?
All righty. So I'm going to do, first of all, I'm going to show you what I was used to in terms of GitHub Copilot, right? So don't worry about all the code here. I definitely didn't. This is a bicep file, right? And I'm deploying stuff up in Azure. And so what I've been used to is, and I hope you see here, GitHub Copilot giving me recommendations, because what I'm doing here is deploying, you know, some virtual networks and whatever, and suddenly it's giving me, you know, I've obviously got to fill in the rest, but it's giving me a hint on the code that I can potentially write. Now, one thing I will say here early on is that GitHub Copilot is going to recommend code based on code. If you expect GitHub Copilot or most generative AI tools to be the senior developer on your team, you're going to fail. I always say that generative AI tools are like your very, very best friend. They're like right next to you and they're like, hey, Hamish, do you want to try this out? Maybe try this out. This might be good. It's not saying, hey, Hamish, this is a better way to code. We as data professionals or, you know, IT professionals need to look at what it is providing us. Mm-hmm. Alrighty. So that's sort of how I got onto GitHub Copilot. And the really cool thing is, and you might notice the extension here is .js, right? JavaScript. Boom, right? I don't know if you saw that, but as I typed in, well, I copied and pasted in, it's now given me the reference data that I need. Because here's the deal. This was a real-life example where I had to go away and get all the ISO country codes. And, you know, going to Wikipedia or looking that up is really long. I just did that in seconds.
Wow.
That's pretty, pretty cool. But here's the kicker, right? And I prefer to bring up the sort of prompty thing within GitHub Copilot, or rather in Visual Studio Code. Oh, it's gone. And ask it to do something. So I want some fake data for first name, last name, street address, and country. And I want to save it to CSV. Okay, so I'm just going to let it do its thing. I like the fact that it said, sure, I can help you. That's brilliant. And boom, we now have the ability to create a CSV with this stuff. So I'm just going to replace this here.
Wow. That's right? Awesome.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it gets better, right? Because I can now, in my terminal, run this, and if I very quickly go away and grab the data, and admittedly, I only brought in 10, and apologies, this is a bit small, but look at that. I don't know any of these people in some of these countries I haven't even heard of. I love the fact that it's the territory itself. Okay. So,
wow.
Look, that is a game changer for me. Yeah. Being able to do this kind of stuff, but this is where it gets even better. This was a real world scenario where I had a client say, "Hey, Hamish, we use Pulumi. You got to write in TypeScript." Anna, until that day, I'd never written in TypeScript. I'd like managed to not write in TypeScript. I was kind of proud that I'd not written in TypeScript. I just wrote in TypeScript. Now, here's the deal. I would not ever productionize this because I want to, you know, create key vaults and I want to get the secrets mm-hmm. and all this kind of stuff. But this is showing me the layout of TypeScript such that I can go away and do all this. Okay, I saved the best till last. I found the chat function in GitHub Copilot. Now, I only found this a month ago, but oh my goodness. It now allows me to use a sort of a ChatGPT interface. And this is going to change the way I work. Now, I will quickly say that, you know, ChatGPT, people say to me, oh, should I use ChatGPT or should I use Copilot? Please use Copilot because it's more secure. It's associated with your Microsoft tenant and what have you. But until I found chat in Visual Code, I was hopping out to ChatGPT, writing stuff, coming back here and doing stuff. I don't have to. It's all here. And it's amazing because it gives me the code. It explains everything. I'm going to do one last demo because this is so exciting, right? Because one of the hardest things to get people to do is to write unit tests for T-SQL.
Yes.
Because everyone says, I don't want to learn C#. Well, there's a really cool utility called T-SQLT. And what has happened here is it has generated the unit test. Now, your results may vary. And in fact, my results have varied here because when I ran this earlier, it gave a different result. It actually went through. Watch that. I'm asking it to tell me what this code looks like. What the heck? Now,
wow.
There is a caveat. It doesn't tell me over here where I generated the code, you've got to actually install T-SQLT, the framework. But that's cool. I just asked it to explain it all, and it's gone away and given a pretty good description of what we have. So.
Wow. That was a lot. Okay, Hamish, I have two questions for you. One, how did you get the chat thing to show up in the VS Code editor?
Yeah, sure. Down here, you can choose. So I have a whole heap of extensions uh-huh. that I've installed over time. And because I've signed up to GitHub Copilot, I get the chat ability. And because I use it so much, it's here. And the really cool thing is it has, you know, just like your normal ChatGPT
right.
By OpenAI, which, you know, Microsoft is a founder of, they are involved with. I can, you know, look at my history and everything. So, yeah, it's once you bring it down awesome. As an extension, yeah, it's there.
Awesome. Great. And then one more in the editor directly when you're editing files, how did you get the inline chat thing?
Oh, yeah, good question. It's really cool. I'm using a Mac, so it's command.
Oh, that was a command. Yeah. Got it.
Yeah. It's really cool. But the cool thing is, if you
I've just used comments in the past, but the
command is new. That's one reason why I did this one here is because people will use comments, but quite often, and there you go, it's given us, and the cool thing is, if you're on Windows, it'll give you, I think it's Control I, it'll give you the Windows specific stuff. It's just giving me the Mac one.
Because it knows, yeah.
I like it. Yeah, it's cool.
Cool. Hamish, once again, awesome. I learned so much. I'm going to go open VS Code right now and play with this stuff. For folks watching, I'm sure you learned something. Please like this episode. Leave us a comment. Let us know what you think. Let us know if you know something you think we don't know, because we'd love to learn. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed MVP Edition.